Rainy day. We're going to be taking our hymn books and turning to page 206, Wonderful Grace of Jesus. So if you'd open up your hymn books and please stand, we'll go ahead and sing. Page 206, Wonderful Grace of Jesus. Grace of Jesus, deeper than the mighty rolling sea, higher than the mountains, sparkling like a fountain, all sufficient grace for even me, broader than the scope of my transgression, greater more than all my sin and shame, for the wonderful precious name of Jesus, praise his name. Wonder grace of Jesus, reaching to all the lost. I have been pardoned, saved to the uttermost. Chains have been torn asunder, giving me liberty. For the wonderful grace of Jesus reaches me. Wonderful, the matchless grace of Jesus, deeper than the mighty rolling sea, higher than the mountains, sparkling like a fountain, all sufficient grace for even me, broader than the scope of my transgressions, greater far than all my sin and shame, oh, magnify the precious name of Jesus, praise his name. Wonderful grace of Jesus, reaching the most defiled, by its transforming power, making him God's dear child, purchasing peace and heaven for all eternity. And the wonderful grace of Jesus reaches me. Wonderful, the matchless grace of Jesus, deeper than the mighty rolling sea, higher than the mountain, sparkling like a fountain, all the chasing grace for even me, broader than the scope of my transgression, greater far than all my sin and shame.
Good to see everybody. Trust you're doing well. Be in prayer one for another. Good singing this morning. Thank you for being here. We figured that the snow would keep some people away. This is our version of it. All right. And, but we are glad you're here this morning. Trust you're doing well. And looks like the rain, at least according to weather, was going to move out today. So hopefully it'll start drying up again. All right. Supposed to be back up in the mid-70s by Tuesday and Wednesday. So right where we like it. Amen. And glad you're here this morning. Do be in prayer one for another. We got some of our folks out. Miss Michelle, I think, is at the urgent care right now, right? She's got a real bad cold or sore throat this morning, so she's there getting that attended to. So you be in prayer for her. And then we got some other folks. Miss Frida's been sick for a week, so be in prayer for Miss Frida that she'll get to feel a little bit better. And then also, May Barbin's been put under hospice care, so be in prayer for her. Ed DeYoung is literally probably not very long from passing away, so be in prayer for the family there, to the young family, Sadie, and all the kids. And then be in prayer for Miss Donna. She goes back to the doctor this week to hopefully get the brace off of her wrist. And then Brother Dan Goodell had some cancer removed this week, so we're glad to, he's doing as well, good as well. So let's be in prayer one for another. Good to see each of you this morning. Good to have the Hall family visiting with us back here in the back. And if we can help anybody with anything, we want to do so. Let's pray together right now. Amen. Lord, we come to you this morning. We thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you for this day you've given us. We thank you for the privilege and the honor to be in your house once again. Live in a country where we have the freedom to come and assemble ourselves together. Lord, I ask you now to be with us and guide us. Help us to have our eyes turned to you this morning. Have our hearts fixed upon your word. Lord, I pray that even right now, as we sing and worship you, I pray that you'd help us to remove any worries that we have for tomorrow or any fears that may be plaguing us. I pray that you'd help us to lay aside the things that has so distracted us in the days gone by. Lord, I pray that right now our minds and our hearts would be cleaned and cleared, that we can hear from you this morning. The Holy Spirit can bring conviction and convincing to our hearts. I ask you, Lord, if there's anyone in this room that's unsaved, to bring conviction this morning and help them recognize their need of a Savior before it's eternally too late. I pray for those that's sick, those that's away from us, those that are working, traveling, whatever the case may be, Lord. I pray that you bring them back safely to us again. We'll give you the praise and glory for all these things. Use this service any way you see fit, Lord, and help us to worship you and adore you with our life. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Keep your hymnal. We're going to sing some more.
Okay, page 230. Grace greater than our sin.
Forward, gentlemen, if you would. Let me make a couple of real quick announcements while they're coming forward. And don't forget about the memorial service this Saturday at 10 o'clock. You see that in your bulletin. So keep up with that. 10 o'clock memorial service, and then right after that, lunch will be provided for all those that come. And then also, we want you to help us out with the desserts. Now, we're going to provide the meal, but if you want to bring desserts, your favorite desserts, Brother Jack's favorite desserts, all those things, you be sure and bring those things on Saturday, all right? And we'll have a great service here. Trust the Lord to do something. We'll have a time of fellowship to follow, so keep up with that. And just as in your bulletin there, you see the family has asked that if you want to do something towards the family, that all donations will be going towards the purchase of some lights for our parking lot out here. So you be in prayer about that, and we're going to ask the Lord to help us get that done very quickly. And also this coming week, tomorrow night and Tuesday night, well, Tuesday all day, if you want to go down to Coronado Baptist Church, Brother Doug Fisher will be preaching down there Monday night and Tuesday night. I won't be able to make it Monday night for our Monday evening School of the Bible, but on Tuesday, if you want, I'll be down there all day on Tuesday, supposed to be one of the preachers during the day, and then Brother Fisher that evening. So if you want to go along for that, let us know afterwards. We'll give you some details about the times. They have a supper if you want to go to that, and then a service to follow that. So keep up with all those things. And then ladies, your fellowship card making class next month on the 24th. Just a heads up for that. And Leilani had a birthday this past week. So happy birthday to her and Brother Strickland. They're not here this morning, but he had one up and coming here. And then Marlene has one up and coming as well. So be in prayer for these folks. But no anniversaries. Still no anniversaries this month. Wowee. And so keep up with all these things. Keep up with your Bible reading and your scripture memorization. Let's be in prayer for all the things that are going on. Looking forward to what the Lord's going to do this day as well as in days to come. Amen. Austin, if you would ask for his blessing upon the offering.
Dear Father, thank you for allowing us to be in your house, Lord. We can come to freely worship you, Lord. We just pray that you just continue to bless us, Lord. Bless everything that we try to do for you, Lord, and the offering that we give to you today, Lord. We pray that you use it to go forth out in the community and also across the world to the missionaries, Lord, that others may come to know you as their personal Savior as well, Lord, and just get the joys and the blessing that only you can give, Lord. We ask these things in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Okay, if you'll go ahead and take your hymnals and turn to page 221, Only a Sinner, and that's Saved by Grace.
Thank you.
righty. Good to see you this morning. I do trust that you will set some things aside this week in your life and ask the Lord to use you. And we've got so many different things to take place. We want to ask the Lord to use all of them for His glory. Amen. Keep up with what's going on. We're going to continue this morning kind of what we started in Sunday school. If you would be turning to the book of Ruth, and we're going to continue on a few things there. And I do want you to pray one for another. Miss Melda's friend Debbie's sister made it back to Canada this week, so be in prayer for Debbie there, and then be in prayer for the up-and-coming memorial service this Saturday. And then Sharon Page's mother this morning was found on the floor, found actually on the floor yesterday, and had surgery this morning to repair a broken hip. So be in prayer for her, and then we'll get an update on that and let you know more about what's going on there. Good to have some of you back that's been sick, been traveling, things like that. We're glad to have you back. Let's be in prayer for those that are still sick. Miss Frieda's been pretty sick for the past week, and like we said earlier, Michelle's at the urgent care right now. So let's be in prayer for these. But Bill's had an exciting week, he and Miss Joyce, and good to have them back with us this morning. And things are getting better. Is that right? Is that fairly accurate, Miss Judy, that they're behaving themselves a little bit better than they were, especially your dad? All right, so good to have them back with us this morning. He had a kind of a rough weekend last weekend, and it's been getting a little bit better this week. But no infection, praise the Lord.
I don't understand why all of this is happening. I've got four women taking care of
me. From where I'm from, I would say it this way, bless your heart. So you be in prayer for Brother Bill as he's got a, he's trying to get better under watchful eyes. And good to have him this morning. Ruth chapter 1 this morning, we start off Sunday school. We won't take the entire time to say everything that we said earlier, but just to kind of set a stage and a review real quickly. In the book of Ruth, we have an amazing story about a man, his wife, and his two sons. They've left Bethlehem, Judah. There was a famine in the land of Bethlehem, and there was some things there that we can look at from scriptures that probably we can look at and see that God was trying to get some attention of some people. It's probably why the famine was there. There was probably some disobedience going by and days going by, or God was just trying to get their attention to look back to Him and trust Him fully. But nevertheless, there was a famine land of Bethlehem, Judah. Elimelech takes his wife Naomi, their two sons. Her name is Naomi. Their two sons is Mahlon and Chilion. They move to Moab. They use the word, we find out, he used the word sojourn, and we find out there in the verse 3 verses that we have an amazing story taking place in just 3 quick verses. They're going to go sojourn in Moab. In other words, there's a famine in Bethlehem, Judah. The father, the husband makes a decision. We're going to relocate and move our family to Moab. You know how it is. The grass is always greener on the other side. And so the conditions it sees was seemed to be perceived to be better there in Moab, so they moved to Moab. And with the terminology in mind, we're going to have a temporary stay there. We're going to sojourn. That's what the word sojourn means. We're going to have a temporary stay. We're just going to pass through, spend a very short time there. But in verse 3, we find end of verse 2, and they continued there. So it wasn't just that they went to visit Moab. It wasn't just to go and see if they could have a better life there or if conditions were better there. They went and they continued there in Moab, which was completely and utterly against God's wishes for them. They made a choice, and we gave the illustration this morning, a very simple illustration that we all would find ourselves sometimes continuing in something that we didn't mean to continue in. We say we're going to put this certain thing on a credit card only for a short time, and then it doesn't work out, and we continue to make credit card payments for months. We're just going to do it for a month or two, but then we didn't pay it off, so we continue. We didn't mean there. We meant to just sojourn there. And we just meant to make one house payment for Mrs. MasterCard or Mrs. Visa that month, you know? But we ended up making car payments, house payments, and mortgage payments and buying them all kinds of extravagant toys for years to come because we continued in something we didn't mean to continue in. It's just a simple illustration, but this is kind of what happens here. We have from the scriptures of Scripture, Elimelech seems to have the mentality in verse 1, a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn, but in verse 2, he continued. Verse 3, Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died. And she was left and her two sons. So upon arrival to Moab, Elimelech has caught maybe disease and he dies. Now Naomi is in a country she doesn't belong in. She has two sons that she needs to raise now as a single mother there in that country. We find out in verse 4, and they took them wives. There was no dad in the house, no husband there, and there was evidently there was a mentality to where they wasn't being obedient to God's command. Deuteronomy chapter 7 tells us that they were not to marry any of those women. Their sons were not to take them as daughters. Their daughters were not to take them as men. And we find that same passage or that same idea all the way forth in the New Testament, that we're not to be unequally yoked together. If we're a child of God, we're not to be unequally yoked together, because what part hath Belial with God? In other words, there's no part where the godly and the ungodly should be together. And there's no part in that. There's no place in God's economy where God wants it to happen. And what happens is, because we be unequally yoked together, it'd be like taking a horse and a mule and putting them in a harness together and saying, plow. They have different mentalities. They have different strengths. They have different ideas. And we have a different drive. A child of God should have no place with the ungodly. And I don't believe that's just in marriage, by the way. I think we need to be careful in partnering in business the same way. Because you're going to have different drives, different motives, different goals, different visions. And if you partner in business or in marriage or any other aspect of life with the ungodly, if you're a child of God and you partner with someone that hasn't trusted Christ as Savior, then you find yourself in a divisive situation. You're trying to go different directions. You have achieved different goals. You have a different vision. And it's very dangerous. So we need to be very careful and diligent in these things. Nevertheless, we get back to the story of Ruth, the book of Ruth. We find now Mahlon and Chilion, the two sons, marrying two Moabitish women. And in marrying these women, without their dad's counsel and guidance, they marry these two women. And 10 years later, amazing things happening so quickly. 10 years later now, by the end of verse 5, we have now her two sons have died. So not only is Elimelech dead, but her two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, are dead. And now we have a widow with two widow daughters-in-law. Two Moabite women that are the daughters-in-law of Naomi. Naomi from Bethlehem, Judah. Ruth and Orpah from Moab. And they're all widowed. 10 short years. What an amazing thing. In such a short amount of time, we find all this happening. Verse 6 says, and she arose with her daughters-in-law, and that she might return from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the country of Moab how that the Lord had visited his people in giving them bread. The word Bethlehem literally means house of bread. So we know that God's blessings wasn't permanently removed from Bethlehem, Judah. It was literally just a thing that God had allowed to happen to maybe get their attention, to get them to look back to him once again. So we find Bethlehem, Judah now being restored. We find God visiting the people. Isn't that an amazing thing? Wouldn't you want God to visit your family? To visit your home? To visit our country? Wouldn't it be wonderful when the countries of the world would know that God visited our country? They're in Moab. But she has heard that God has visited his people there in Bethlehem, Judah. So she arises. She gets up. She says, I'm going to move back to where I belong, where I should have been all along. I'm going to make an application. We need to get back to God's will for our life, God's purpose for our life. I gave an illustration this morning in Sunday school. So many times we catch ourselves, well, we're just not going to do this for a while. I'm just going to miss a little bit. I'm just going to not read my Bible. I'm just not going to pray because I have this other thing and this other thing. And I'm just going to just sojourn. I'm just going to take a temporary visit away from, but I'll be right back. And we find ourselves, if we're not careful, continuing not to read our Bible, continuing not to pray, continuing not to be faithful with our life. We never intended for that, but we find ourselves living in a continuing state of being out of God's purpose and plan. Naomi arises. She's buried her husband. She's buried her two sons. She's in a land where she doesn't really know anybody. It's not her people. She shouldn't be there in the first place. She's got two daughters-in-law that are from that country. It's not her culture. It's not her comfort zone. She hears that God has visited his people there in Bethlehem, Judah. She says, I'm going to go back. And she meets with her two daughters. I'm going to go back. And at first, the embrace is, we'll go with you. But then not long, we find out that one of the daughters-in-law says, you know, Ruth reasons with them, says, listen, you're too young. If I were to, even if God were to give me two more sons, another husband somewhere down the line, and two more sons down the line, you wouldn't want to wait for 18 or 20 years for them to grow up to marry my two sons. You're young. You need to go ahead and find another husband and ask God to help you with that. And she reasons with them, and they said, no, we're going with you. They loved her, and she loved them. But then it's not long till when she gets really ready to leave that basically she meets with them again and shares with them that she's going back. And Orpha says, well, I've decided that I'm not going to go. I'm going to stay here. But Ruth says, no, your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. There was something that Ruth had seen in Naomi's life, and I say this very carefully. I think we would be safe to say that Naomi was probably in somewhat of a discouraged and maybe even backslidden condition in her life, in her walk with the Lord. But she determined at some point in time, I'm going to return. I'm going to get back to where I need to be. And that's not an easy process sometimes. Because we have so much baggage that goes with us. We have emotional baggage. We have physical baggage. We have financial baggage. We have all kinds of baggage. So I'm just going to go back. I'm just going to go back to God. The devil reminds us, so you can't go back. You got all these friends. You got this job. You got this career. You got these promises you made to these people. And all of a sudden the devil reminds us of all these things of this world that keeps us from going back to where God wants us. I said to you this morning, we have to quit looking at and listening to the world and listening to the prince and the power of the air. That's the devil himself. We got to quit listening to these folks. I'm talking to myself this morning. I need to return to where God wants me to be. If there's something in my life, it's not where it ought to be. If there's something that I've laid down and I've spent too much time there, I should have never been there in the first place. I should have never visited there. But even if I visited there, I should not have stayed there. I should not have continued there. Maybe a mindset. I gave illustration this morning. If we give more of our time to every week to listening to the news than we do to listening to God, it's going to affect our mind. So you against news? No, I like the news. Hey, let me get off of the news for a minute. If we give too much time to watching movies, it's going to affect our mind. That's not reality. It's scripted. We know that, right? If something says reality TV, that means it's the most unreality thing there is. It's scripted. We know that. We know that, right? Young people, you know that? Make sure you tell your parents, all right? And it'll affect our mind. We'll start thinking that, what, this and that, and did you not see that movie? Wait a minute. That movie is not reality. That movie is scripted. There may be some things that happens in shows and movies that we can say, well, I remember when that happened. But wait a minute. That's not the life that you and I live in. And those scenarios and those things that's portrayed there are portrayed to get our attention, to get us to watch, because there's sponsorships involved and there's money exchanging hands. And they're going to put some things up that appeal to us, no doubt about it. But we have to look to God's Word. And if we spend more time watching movies, listening to the news, playing the games of the world, listening to the world, if we spend more time doing all those things that we do, giving it to God, thinking about things of God, it will affect our thinking. There's no way around it. If a doctor diagnoses you with something and says, we can't do anything about this, that doesn't mean that no one can. Brother Grover, we're going to have a memorial service this coming Saturday. Miss Phyllis is back here, faithful. I love Miss Phyllis and her faithfulness, and she's been a great testimony, her and Brother Jack, and you'll hear more about that on Saturday. But here's the thing about it. Just because the doctors couldn't do anything for Brother Jack doesn't mean the Lord couldn't. He's not diseased today. Right? We say, yeah, but that's not what I was talking about when I wanted to be healed. Do you get more healing than you can get from God? Can you be more healed than get a brand spanking new body that's not tainted and carries forth the condemnation of sin on it? Well, that's not what I had in mind. Maybe it's not what we had in mind. Let me remind you, sometimes what we think
And what we allow ourselves to think is not always the reality of the world that we live in. I think right now about Ed DeYoung, him and Sadie, how they immigrated to this country years ago. And they came through Canada and into the United States and worked their whole life and farmed and met Ed and Sadie and those people all over the world. Literally, don't they, Julene? They know. When Margaret Stringer was here, Ed was hoping to come to meet her because he was almost positive they would know some of the same people where she served as a missionary. Honestly. He never, maybe they didn't script everything coming up like it is right now. But sometimes the world that we live in is not the same world that we think about. So we need to be careful that we don't find ourselves staying in a mindset longer than God wants us to. We've had the book of Ruth here. We talked about this morning about our country. Our country, we need God to visit our country. Listen, don't get me wrong. That flag, I will fight you for. You may burn that flag, and you may have the freedom to burn that flag, but you won't burn it in front of me. Because I have the freedom to protect that flag. You understand what I'm saying? We lay down our freedoms and our liberties. They're not taken from us. We lay them down because we're scared. I mentioned this morning, we're scared to parent. Well, we can't tell our kids no. We can't tell them. We can't, because really? I read God's Word and it says our parents has a responsibility of training up their children. Not the government. The parents. Do we recruit some help? Of course we can recruit some help. I'm not saying we don't get some help and assistance from some places. There's nothing wrong with the school system. Listen, several folks in this church work in the school system, but it's the parents' place to train up the child. If you're going to use the school to help with do that, then make sure you watch the school. Right? Because God holds the parents accountable. And yet we're afraid to parent. We're afraid to take a stand on God's Word because we'll offend somebody. Do we love the praise of man or the praise of God? In other words, who are we trying to offend? We're not trying to offend anyone. We're to live our life without offense. But as long as we stand upon God's Word, we're not providing the offense. The truth is what divides. Amen. The truth is what separates, not us. Jesus Christ Himself, the Bible says He was wise as a serpent, harmless as a dove. Think about that for a moment. Wise as a serpent, harmless as a dove. He didn't go around turning over tables everywhere He went. But if He needed to, He could, didn't He? But He spoke in love, He spoke in peace, but He spoke the truth. The truth is what separates and divides. It's not going to be us. We have here from the book of Ruth, again, we have them going on. Naomi says, I'm going back. Ruth says, I'll go with you. Your people, my people. Orpah says, I'm staying there. A dear friend of mine, he's in glory now, Ed Reese. Ed Reese, one time I heard him preaching on this back in 1999, I believe it was, and he made a statement. He gave a quick biographical sketch of Ruth's life. He said, oh, we're about out of time, but let's quickly look at Orpah's life. Let's see what God did with her. Oh, there is no book called Orpah. There's one that bears Ruth's name. You say, well, what do you mean by that? I just thought it was an interesting way that he closed that message out. You want to see what God will do with you? Look at the choices Orpah made. Look at the choices Ruth made. God literally put her story and God's grace in His eternal book and put her name on it as a reference for us to find it. He didn't do that for Orpah. So what's that mean? That God recognizes only, and only those He recognizes He blesses? That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying, if we live obedient to God's Word, we find God's blessings. We find them going back. Naomi now, she goes back to Bethlehem, Judah, chapter 2. We find that she returns to Bethlehem, Judah, and Ruth alongside. And that journey was not an easy journey. You got two widows traveling. There wasn't government systems in place to provide for them. They make it back to Bethlehem, Judah, and now they walk into the town, and I'm moving quickly, so I'm just going to talk through it. They move into the town real quickly, And they move into the town. I mean, as they're walking through the town, people are going, "Who is that woman? Who?" They've never met Ruth, remind you. She's from Moab. But Naomi's from Bethlehem, Judah. Just over 10 years has passed. 10 years, roughly. A little over 10 years. And she's walking down the street and they say, "Who is that woman?" People see her walking. Who? And then someone says, is that Naomi? My goodness, life's been hard on her. Her life bore the scars of the wrong decision. No doubt she was aged. No doubt she was worn. How many of you realize stress takes a toll on you? Look at any president of our country when they took office and look at them when they get out. Yeah, that's less than 10 years. The longest they can serve is 8. And when they get out, they look way older than they did when they went in. The stress of living in the wrong decisions in the wrong place, out of God's purpose and plan. The heartache of life, of living there in a place where she wasn't supposed to be. Her husband dying, her sons dying, her burying the men of her life. It took its toll on her. Naomi comes back into town, and somebody maybe finally says, "Oh, is that Naomi?" You can read it. It's all there in 4 short chapters. Literally, these details are there. Is that Naomi? And then they put it together. That is Naomi. And Naomi settles. And Ruth alongside of her. Well, of course, they have no groceries. They just got to town. How many of you ever come back from vacation or come back from a trip and one of the first things you had to do is go to town because you needed some groceries? They didn't have anything. There wasn't Safeways and Walmarts and Fry's and Albertsons and Sam's Clubs. So you know what they did? Ruth says, "I'm going out to glean in the field." The only provision there was for widows, not the only one, but the majority, the major provision for widows was that the farmers, those that farmed, when they harvested, they would leave the corners of the fields so that the widows could come and glean what grew in the corners of the fields. So Ruth, her daughter-in-law, says, "I'm going to go glean in the field." And I love chapter 2 because it says in verse 2, "And Ruth the Moabitess said unto Naomi, let me now go in the field and gleaners of corn after him in whose sight I shall find grace. And she said unto her, go, my daughter. And she went and came and gleaned in the field after the reapers. And her hap," I love that, "and her hap was to light on a part of the field belonging unto Boaz, who was the kindred of Elimelech." Let me say this. It just so happened. Now we understand that wasn't chance or luck. That was God's provision. It was God's mercy. So if you found your life in a place where you've been there longer than you meant to, mentally, emotionally, or spiritually, you found yourself, "I didn't mean to get this," and maybe the Holy Spirit's convicting you or has convicted you about it, and you didn't mean to be that far away from God, and you think right now, when's the last time you picked up the Bible, and when's the last time I read the Bible, when's the last time I memorized a verse, when's the last time I read my devotion, or when's the last time I prayed without wanting something, just thanking Him? And we find ourselves, "Well, I didn't mean to." And you, in your mind right now, you're saying, "How did I get so far? What's happened to me? How have I thought so strangely that I found myself this far away from where I used to be or where I need to be?" I have conversations with people regularly in kind of a counseling type environment. That question's asked a lot. I don't know how I got to where I'm at. I don't know what happened to me. I used to be so. Let me say something. If that's you this morning, you're not alone. And you've not removed yourself from God's love. But do as Naomi did. Whatever it cost me, and whatever ridicule I have to endure, and whatever I look like doing it, I'm going to get back to where I need to be. And she takes her Moabitess daughter-in-law and they leave. And there was cost, and there was suffering, and upon arriving in town, there was even some ridicule. And they get there, and Naomi is tired and maybe a little depressed because there wasn't some big welcoming parade for her to come back. And Ruth says, I'm going to the field to glean. And she says, okay, go. And it just so happened that she fell upon the field of Boaz. And Boaz, it's an amazing thing, is a picture of Christ. When you read the entire book, you find that out. But Boaz is the owner of this field. She gets there, she starts reaping in the field. Look at verse 4. And behold, Boaz... Wait, let me get into verse 3 because this is important. Her hap was laid on the field, part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was the kindred of Elimelech. Wait a minute. It's not just Boaz's field. It's Naomi's husband, who is now deceased. It's kin to the family. Remember, Ruth has never met the family. Ruth doesn't know who to look for. She's not familiar with Bethlehem, Judah. She's not been there. She's never lived there. She don't know who owns what. She don't know who anybody is. And she lands in a field belonging to Boaz, who was kin to Elimelech. And behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem. Did you catch that? And said unto the reapers, the Lord be with you. You say, what do you mean, did you catch that? He came from where he was supposed to be. You know the best way to go to work? Coming from where you're supposed to be. You know the best way to go home? Coming from where you're supposed to be. You know the best way to get anything done? Coming from where you're supposed to be. But wait a minute. Ruth wasn't where she was supposed to be. Naomi wasn't where she was supposed to be. But it's not going to be long. You're going to find out they get back to where they're supposed to be. So what are you... Find yourself today in God's purpose and plan for your life, or continuing in a place where you shouldn't be, you can still get back to where you're supposed to be. Boaz said to his servant that was set on verse 5, chapter 2, said to his servant that was set over the reapers, whose damsel is this? He comes upon the field, he's checking upon his workers, he's a diligent farmer, and he's talking to his workers, there's so many things here, there's no way we can get through all of them. But look at how Boaz greets his employees. Verse 4, he said to the reapers, the Lord be with you. How'd you like to have that boss? Your boss shows up, says, well, amen, you had a good night. God bless you today. We're praying for you while you're on the job today. Let me know if I can do anything for you. Would you like to have that boss? Not, why aren't you working harder? No, he greets his employees with a greeting from God, the Lord be with you. And they answered him, the Lord bless thee. You know what these workers figured out? Without God's blessings on on Boaz, we don't have God's blessings on us because he owns the field. And let me remind you about planting and sowing. You can plant all the seed you want. You can plow up all the ground you want. You can even water it all you want if you have the water. But you can't make it grow and you can't bring forth harvest. There's a Lord of the harvest. And these workers said, our livelihood, our life is dependent upon God Almighty. We need God's blessings upon our boss, upon the owner of this field, so that our livelihood is sustained through him. And the boss, if you will, I'm using that word loosely, Boaz says, I need God's blessings because I need their health intact. And their willingness to work with the right attitude, because we can't do this alone. And can I say that this morning, in this church, in this community, we got to work together. It's not about the pastor, it's not about the members of the church, it's about everyone in the church working together for the cause of Christ. It's about those in the family of God, that the different members, in particular parts of the body, working together to bring glory to God, to get the work done. There's not one that's more important or less important than anyone else. There's no big I's and little U's. All of us are on the same page in God's eyes. God's purpose and plan for your life and calling on your life is just as important as God's purpose and plan for my life. He doesn't view those in the pews any less. He doesn't view those in the pulpit as any more. It's God's purpose and plan. It's obedience or disobedience, period. And he simply says, as he comes upon the field, and he looks across the field, he says, hey, who's this woman over here reaping? And they said, verse 6, the servant was set over the reapers, answered and said, it's the Moabitess damsel that came back with Naomi out of the country of Moab. See, the news travels fast. Rumor mills are not anything new. They run wide open everywhere. And Naomi, as she comes into town, she's walking through town, people seeing her, oh, is that Naomi? Oh, my goodness, life's been hard on her. No doubt, right? You even find some of those things out there in Scripture that they're talking like that. So the news has already traveled. Boaz has already heard about Ruth. He's never met Ruth. She knows who she is. But she just knows there's a Moabitess woman. By the way, kind of the enemies of God's people. Remember Deuteronomy chapter, sorry, I wrote down somewhere, 7, verses 1 through 3. They were not to marry those people. Matter of fact, they were, when they went in, God were going to give them of these seven greater nations, that God were going to give them this land, of these seven greater nations God provided for them, and they were supposed to utterly destroy them. They weren't completely obedient. And now we have the Moabitess woman coming back. So when you say the Moabitess woman, it was a very derogatory term. The employee says, that's the Moabitess woman that came back with Naomi from Moab. Notice this real quickly, Boaz's response. Verse 7, she said, I pray you, let me glean. The worker is now telling Moab what she says. She says, I pray you, let me glean and gather after the reapers among the sheaves. So she came and have continued from evening into morning now that she tarried a little in the house. You say, why did Ruth catch his eyes? Because she wasn't where the widows normally were. She wasn't in a corner of the field. She was in the field. She said, can I pray and follow the reapers and anything that among the sheaves in the middle of the field? And he says, and I've let her, and she's continued from the morning until now, and she tarried a little in the house. I got that word little underlined and in italics in my Bible. You know why? She didn't show up in town and say, well, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm just going to sit back. I'm just going to wait and see what happens. No. She got to town. She immediately, as soon as they get settled, she immediately says, Naomi, we got to go. We got to have some food. And I'm going to work. I'm going to glean. So she didn't spend a lot of time sitting around feeling sorry for herself, throwing a pity party. She went to work and she started gleaning early in the morning. And now late in the evening, we still find her there. The Bible says God helps those that helps themselves. See, we want to sit back and we think God's some big welfare program. We just want to sit back and say, well, if he really loves me, he'll just give me whatever I want. No, he'll supply our every need. But he wants to know how serious we are about serving him as well. He even gives from his bio, from God's own word. God says, if a man doth not provide for his own, he's worse than an infidel. And if he doesn't work, he shouldn't eat. If a man has the physical and the mental capacity to provide, and he doesn't provide, then he's worse than an infidel. That's not my words. That's the words of God. Right. Ruth shows up, and she spends a little time in the house. She's not taking long breaks. She spent just a little bit of time resting, and she went to work. Look at verse 8. Then said Boaz unto Ruth, hearest thou not my daughter? So far, no conversation between Boaz and Ruth. Boaz only knows of Ruth through his servant. But now we have Boaz approaching Ruth and saying, I need you to listen to what I'm going to say. You see that question mark? Hearest thou not, comma, my daughter? Pay attention. Don't be looking around. Go not to glean in another field. This is what Boaz is now telling Ruth. Don't go anywhere else, neither go from hence, but abide here fast by my maidens. Let thine eyes be on the field that they do reap, and go thou after them. Have I not charged the young men that they shall not touch thee? And when thou art athirst, go into the vessels and drink of that which the young men have drawn. He says, listen, this is not just some ordinary field you're in. This is my field. And I know who you are. You're the daughter-in-law of my family member. You are my family. You are now going to be part of my maidens. You're going to serve, you're going to glean in my field. I own the field. The harvest belongs to me. And I'm telling you, everything here belongs to you, not just the corners. It all belongs to you. And your provisions for every day will be provided from me. You don't have to bring your own water. You go right to where the men that working in the fields go. They're going to draw the water, and it's going to be there for your taking. You're working, but you don't have to work for my provisions. I will provide for you. That's an amazing thing, isn't it? I'm using the word my on purpose this morning because, as I said earlier, Boaz is the picture of Christ. And if we really believe the Bible, we know that the Bible teaches that He is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Prince of Peace, the Comforter, the Messiah, the Savior. He owns the hills, the cattle on the hills, and the wealth in every mind. There is nothing that we can get that doesn't come from Him. Every good gift coming from above in the Father of lights. Every good gift. He only gives good gifts, and no gift cometh that is good except it come from Him. So we can't think, well, I earned that and I worked hard for that. Who give you the health, the strength, the job, the ability? Why? Listen, it's not about the ability. It's about the heart. Ruth said, I'm going to do all I can do for the right reason. Boaz says, it all belongs to me and I'm going to do what I want to do. And I don't want you looking anywhere else. Isn't that a great message for us? Don't be looking to some other place to find God's provisions. Don't be looking for some other place. Well, but the world and that investment and that, listen, I'm not against investments and retirement programs, but be careful that you don't trust them more than you trust God. They'll crash and burn. But even in times of desolation, Naomi and Ruth found provision. It's an amazing thing. It goes on here, and we've got to hurry. He says, in verse 10, she fell on her face and bowed herself to the ground and said unto him, why have thou found grace in thine eyes that thou shouldest take knowledge of me, seeing I'm a stranger? You don't even know me. Why would you do this for me? And Boaz answered and said unto it, it hath been fully showed me all that thou hast done unto thy mother-in-law since the death of thine husband, and how thou hast left thy father and thy mother and the land of thy nativity, and art come unto a people which thou knowest not heretofore. Did you catch this real quickly? Something we often don't look at in the book of Ruth. Ruth, we often think, well, Ruth went with Naomi. She should have. Wait, really? When's the last time you made a decision that your family didn't agree with for the cause of Christ? Boaz said, you've left your father and your mother. You've come with your mother-in-law. Yeah. They're not the enemy. They ought not be the enemy. You've come with your mother-in-law. You've cared for... Do you think that Ruth and Naomi probably agreed on every little detail of life? Probably not. You know why I know that? Because they're human. Really. But Naomi was from the right place, the right people, and was trying to get back to the right place and the right people. And Ruth says, your people will be my people and your God's going to be my God. She recognized that maybe there had been some disobedience and a lack of faith from some of her own family. And she says, I'm choosing that which is right above even my own family. And she goes back. Bible says in verse 12, the Lord recompense thy work and a full reward by giving thee of the Lord God of Israel under whose wings thou art come to trust. He says, let me tell you why I've given favor on you. It's not because of me. It's because of the Lord. The Lord has rewarded me. He's given me so many things. I realize what faithfulness does, and I really recognize your faithfulness, and I recognize it's your love and your trust in God. And because I recognize who you are, what you're trying to do, then the Lord lays on my heart to do more for you because He'll do more for me. Isn't it an amazing thing? The Bible says if we draw nigh to Him, He'll draw nigh to us. Catch that? Well, how do I get back to where I am? You just turn around. How do I get back from where I'm at? We just turn around. We'll quit making the wrong decisions and make the right decision. I know that's tough to understand. And I'm not saying that lightly. It is for our mind. We say, but you don't understand how I got. You don't know how, what a mess I've made. You don't understand how what a disaster. And I don't know how to fix it all. Don't worry about fixing it all. Just turn around. Draw nigh to Him. He'll draw nigh to thee. He'll fix it. You think Ruth could have fixed this mess? You think Naomi could have fixed this mess? But Ruth trusted the Lord, and the Lord led her to a field where the Lord would provide for her in a way that she couldn't be provided for in any other field, to a man that was kin to her father-in-law, to a man that had wealth and prestige, to a man that had the ability to provide for them. And we're going to hurry. It wasn't just providing for the food for the day, but what it boils down to is this. Boaz wasn't married. You know who Boaz's mother was? Rahab the harlot. Wait a minute. His mother was a harlot? Was. Amen. At Jericho. And then God's messenger showed up and gave her the truth. And she believed. And her household believed. And of all the people in Jericho, only her and her household survived because of the scarlet cord that was cast out the window through obedience. Remember, we talked about blessings for obedience and punishment for disobedience. The blessings of obedience provided provision, and her family was saved. And she had a child, and his name was Boaz. And now we find Boaz in Bethlehem, Judah, the owner of a field, the son of a harlot, where God is sending a Moabitish woman from an ungodly, false cult background with a woman that needs to be back where she needs to be in God's will and purpose for her life and sends her into that field. Listen, God, there is no mistakes or accidents with God. And if you and I think that we can fix it, we are fooling ourselves. God is in control. He'll do whatever He wants to do with whoever He wants to do when He wants to do it. We have to turn back to Him. Draw nigh to Him. He'll draw nigh to us. As soon as Naomi said, I'm going back. Whoa, that changed the whole game. Because now God is working for Naomi, not against Naomi. And for Ruth, not against Ruth. And it changed everything in their future. To the point that now we won't have time. But you read and you find out that literally she enters the bloodline of Christ. There is no way that we can script this. We don't live in a scripted world. We got to quit listening to and watching and giving so much attention to the things that are scripted. We have to be giving our attention by faith. We live by faith, not by sight. We're going to turn to Him, draw close to Him. He's going to draw close to us. And we think about these things in our life. We think about these things in our country. Listen, I can't change this country and you can't either. I'll do my part. I'm a registered voter. I'll vote every election, local, state, and national. I'll study the people I'm voting for. But that's not going to change things. Politicians won't change things. Only God working through people that trust Him changes things. I think we got some good people in offices. I think we've had good people in office every administration. You say you agree with everybody and everything? No one and nothing. In other words, there's things I disagree with every decision everybody makes. Because I'm human and you are too, and we always say that. But I think there's good people in place that God has put in place for a time to give our country one more chance to turn back to Him. But it's going to start with us turning back to Him. Everything we read in the book of Ruth, and by the way, that's just four chapters, but there's so much there. But there's so much more that follows the book of Ruth we can read about this story. But that only happened because an individual turned back, not because a nation turned back. An individual turned back. And that individual's life impacted other people's lives and caused them to turn back and turn to God. And the true God became their God. And the true way of faith became the way of faith. And the true blessings of God became the blessings in their life. And we find out that they went from a place that was stricken with famine in chapter 1, verse 1, to a place that God didn't want them. Back to the place that God was blessing, which is where they was from in the beginning. And God provided for them. You say, well, what do you think the purpose for going there was? I don't know. But I can say this, even in the wrong choice that Elimelech made by taking his family there. Because remember now, Naomi's back in Bethlehem, but her husband and her sons are buried there in Moab. An everyday reminder. There was some wrong choices that we made. Ruth, on the other hand, is in Bethlehem, and all of her family is back there. An everyday reminder, the right choices I've made. Even though there was wrong choices made, God got the glory. And it wasn't just because Naomi was returned. Really, it's not named, the book that is not named Naomi. It's about the faith that Ruth learned by following and walking with Christ. So I say to you this morning, where are you at in your life? What choices have you made that are wrong? Better Grove Memorial Service is coming up this Saturday. As Miss Phyllis and I a week ago were sitting looking through some pictures together, she pulled up a man's name. What was his best friend's name? Claude. We look at these pictures, she says, that's Claude. I'd heard of Claude. Bert Jack had talked about Claude. Miss Phyllis, if I get this wrong, you correct me. Bert Jack got saved. Claude was his drinking buddy. But it wasn't long until Claude got saved. Hey, so there was some wrong choices made. We're going to turn back and we're going to try to take someone else with us. Amen? We're not just going to say, I'm walking away. I am walking away, but by the grace of God, I want to take someone with me that goes with me. Your testimony is something that God uniquely gives you that He doesn't give anyone else of how you get saved. Whatever your past, whatever bad decisions, whatever wrong decisions, whatever ungodly choices you made with your life, today, if you're still living in those, if you're still continuing there, as chapter 1, verse 3 says, you went just to visit there. Well, I'm just going to go with them. Listen, teenagers, you're going to tell your parents these things. You're going to have these thoughts. I know that. Listen, it's just my friends. I'm not going to do what they're going to do. It's just my friends. And you don't really mean to do what they're doing. You don't mean to do drugs once. But they're just your friends and they're doing them, but you're not. And you don't mean to paint on the side of that building, but that's just your friends and you're just driving the car. You're not really painting it. And you're not going to do these different things. You're not going to act this certain way, say these certain words, watch this certain video, look this certain thing. You're not going to do those things. I know you don't mean to, young people. I know that. But I'm telling you, if you go there, you'll find yourself staying there. It happens more often than you want to think. It's just my friends. I'm just going to go with them. And even when they're gone, you still find yourself staying. Some of my friends, young people that I went to high school with, are already in eternity. Some of them died very, very young. There are consequences for decisions that are not guided by God's Word. And you know what? If I'm not careful, I'll find myself continuing in those decisions. Because we get easy. It's comfortable. It's easy to live there. Naomi had already lived there for 10 years. She kind of had some grounding now. She's been widowed, but her daughters-in-law are there, and her daughters-in-law families are there. And it would have been real easy for her to say, well, I just need somebody, life's so hard. And they said, well, honey, come on over here. We'll take care of you. And you can live with us. And she could have had a life there in Moab. She already had a life there in Moab. But she said, this is not where I'm supposed to be. God has visited his people in Bethlehem. Not people have visited people. God is in Bethlehem. I want to get back to where God wants me, not just where my family and my friends want me. I want to get back to where God wants me. And it wasn't an easy choice. But she turned and she headed back towards God, and God drew nigh close to her. And I'm telling you, that changed not only her future, but it changed the future of Ruth. And praise be to God, it changed the future of generation after generation after generation after generation after generation. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed this morning, I want to simply ask you this question.